So, hi, welcome back to our 12th C++ programming lecture. So, what are we going to talk about today? Ah, first of all, maybe a quick note on the final lecture and also on the introduction to the final project. So, there will be two additional lectures next week on Friday, 17th of July. We'll have a lecture on static analysis, which probably will also help you to better understand the C and C++ compiler, especially optimizing compilers. So on a very high level, I will explain what static analysis is, how it is used within your compiler, and it will probably help you to write better code and also code that can be better understood by the compiler. Because essentially, optimizing compilers are using static analysis as a concept under the hood to obtain information on which they base their optimization. So very helpful to know this kind of stuff. And then on Friday, 24th of July, so in 2 weeks essentially, we are having the final lecture where I introduce you to the final project. So I will present what the final project is. We will discuss what your tasks will be, and also we will talk about some miscellaneous stuff, so some funny hacks and all that good stuff might be also really interesting. Especially you should at least attend or listen to or watch the recording of the final project introduction, and then you can decide whether you also wish to see the miscellaneous stuff and the hacks really. So, today we are talking about high-performance computing in general, at first. Then we will talk about high-performance computing in C++. So that means what are C++'s concepts for high-performance computing. Especially it will be about running your programs in parallel. So at least I will give you some tools to run certain tasks in your program in parallel. So it sounds harder than it actually is. We will see about that. Finally, we will discuss one concrete example where we run a matrix multiplication. And at the beginning, we will see that this matrix multiplication is kind of really, really slow. And so we give ourselves the task basically to speed up that matrix multiplication, and we'll see how far we can come. So in terms of speed up, what kind of speed up we can achieve really, starting from a naive matrix multiplication example. This also includes then some important compiler flex I'm going to present to you. So compiler flex that you should definitely know as a C++ programmer. Also, again, this will become even more clear with the next lecture on static analysis. How can you help the compiler to generate really efficient, really high-performant code? So that's very interesting, I guess. And what the compiler can already do for you. So your job is then kind of not to work against the compiler, but rather try to support the compiler such that it can do its job as good as possible. So first of all, high performance computing, why should you care? Is that really important? There's of course a great demand for computation power, and even more, I mean, the more computation power you have, the better, and you can really, with help of computation power, you can generate money. I already told that once in a previous lecture, if I recall correctly. So there are automated trading systems from the major banks, which are essentially C++ programs, which read all the data from stock markets, and then they feed it into a mathematical model. They solve the mathematical model, and given the answer, the solution of that model, they buy or sell other stocks to generate money. And if you're fast enough, you can always buy stocks cheap, and sell them expensive and generate money out of nothing, kind of, just by being fast and being faster than all of your competitors, really. So that's one kind of difficult use case, at least for a moral standpoint. Of course, we also have simulations, so driving simulations, flight simulations, which I use to get some insights. And I mean, it's easier to crash a car against the wall, and also safer and probably cheaper to crash a car against a wall in a simulation rather than building a real car and crashing that into a wall. That's more time consuming and also more expensive, I guess. And you probably don't want to sit, you don't want to have real people in that car for obvious reasons, right? But also for weather forecasts, so, and what the weather for tomorrow will be like. It's mostly a three-dimensional cellular automaton, so similar to the Game of Life, but with one additional dimension and some more extensive rule sets. Driving simulation, I already said that. Also drug design, so you can even simulate how molecules on a chemical or biochemical level interact with each other, such that you can design drugs on a computer, and you can then in a simulation check how that drug interacts with certain other chemical substances. Computer graphics as well, power plants, and whatnot, really. So, and the more computation power you have, the more precise simulations that you get, or the more you can do in the same amount of time, obviously. And usually the computer can achieve those results much cheaper. So a simulation is always cheaper than doing things in reality. And yeah, parallel computation. So if you wish to speed up your programs, you can also try to do stuff in parallel. And that is what we are going to discuss mostly about today. Unfortunately, of course, there's a catch. So the implementation of a highly efficient program is, first of all, a time-consuming task, and also oftentimes a nerve-wracking task. So there's some guys who love that kind of stuff, but also some people hate it. So you have to decide for yourself, I guess, on which side you you are. So if we talk about high-performance computing, we first of all have to talk about the hard physical limits which we have here in the real world. So we cannot just make computer chips with a faster clock rate, because the clock rate is kind of limited by physics, really. So first of all, the higher you clock your CPU, the more power does it consume. So power consumption is one concern, really. Another concern is heat. So if you melt down your machine because the processor becomes too warm, too hot, that's also unfortunate. So you also need to have some kind of cooling capabilities. And really the main point here of that hard physical limit slide is signals can unfortunately only really travel at the speed of light. That's the main restricting factor, actually. Unless you have, maybe you could construct a warp CPU that curves space-time and never mind. So let's maybe do a small computation here. So if you have a CPU processor which has a clock rate of 3 GHz, that means that it has only the time for one cycle is then a third of a nanosecond. So whatever needs to be done must happen in one third of a nanosecond. And now maybe let's see what the maximal distance a signal can travel in a third of a nanosecond is. Let's compute that. So let's assume the upper limit in speed of light in the vacuum is 1 over 3 times 10 to the 9 meters per second. And this is best, basically, best case. Yeah, usually it's slower because we don't have a vacuum and yeah, we don't have light, so we have electrical signals in some circuitry. And if you do the math, really, you will end up, if you multiply the speed of light times the quarter of a nano, the third of a nanosecond, you'll end up with a number of 10 centimeters. And that means that you can't build chips larger than 10 centimeters. Current chips are currently the size of 2 to 4 centimeters. And I mean, you have to consider that a signal must be able to travel between two arbitrary positions on the CPU within one cycle. And the most you can travel in that third of a nanosecond is 10 centimeters. So the upper limit of a chip size is really just only 10 centimeters. And this is really assuming best conditions here, speed of light in the vacuum. Usually it's a bit slower, unfortunately. So we have hard physical limits, really. Let's maybe talk about processor development. So first of all, there's a thing called Moore's Law. And he says that, the law says, I mean, he said it, and the law then says or states that the complexity of integrated circuits doubles every year. And what's meant with that is basically the number of transistors. But the problem is that the clock rate is limited. So yeah, how can we use the additional transistors for? So what can we use them for? And if you think about it, you already know the answer, kind of. Because first of all, we can increase the number of processor cores. So we can, and we already have that nowadays, that we have processors with a huge amount of CPU cores. So build more CPU cores on that chip with limited clock rate, of course, but we can use the additional transistors to do that. We can also have some redundant ALU and FPU, so arithmetic and logic unit. That's the thing that does logic, so bool comparison and also integer arithmetic. So it's basically the core of a CPU, which is the actual computation unit. And we also have a special floating point unit, because integers and floating point numbers are kind of represented in a different manner on the CPU chip. And for the floating point numbers, you have a specialized unit, which is called floating point unit, which does all the floating point computation stuff. Then we can introduce more registers. So registers are kind of storage that the CPU can use, so it can store variables within the registers, and that's the fastest piece of memory that you have on your chip. We can increase the amount of cache memory. Later on in this lecture, we will see why cache memory is really important and what it can do for you. Or we can also build specialized hardware. For instance, we can build graphic processing units. And then we can try to implement programs within CUDA or OpenCL, and we can try to express our programs for the computer in those specialized language programming models, such that they can run on the specialized hardware, which can execute the instructions much faster. In order to be able to do that, you need your problem to be solved needs some special properties, of course. Usually it's about data parallelism here. And here's a picture of Moore's Law, and it turns out to be true, at least till 2011. So I haven't picked a more recent picture or figure. I would need to check if it's still kind of true, but I guess it probably is. Okay, so then parallel computing. So how can we make things faster? how can we make our programs faster? How can we parallelize stuff such that we can do more in less time? And there are four levels of parallelism that you have in your CPU, basically. So, first of all, you have parallelism on a bit level. So, early computers used a small number of bits for their register sizes, so also called word size. So, there have been computers which only had a word size of 1 byte. Today, usually we have 32 bits, bit size registers, or even more common nowadays are 64-bit architectures where a register can hold 64, one individual register can hold 64 bit at a given time. That's one kind level of parallelism. Then we have a second level of parallelism, and that's called parallelism through pipelining. And what you do is, rather than do one instruction at a time, the idea is that you divide each instruction into multiple subtasks. So you divide one instruction in subtasks, namely, for instance, fetch the instruction, decode the instruction, execute the instruction, and then write back the result. And now, instead of handling one instruction at a time, you kind of pipeline instructions. That means, at the very beginning, of course, in the first clock cycle, in the first cycle, you fetch the first instruction. Then within the next cycle, you decode that very first instruction that you already fetched in the last cycle, but in addition, already fetch some new instruction. So in one cycle, you decoded the previous fetched instruction, and you already fetch the next one. And then in the next cycle, you now execute the decoded instruction, you decode the fetched instruction, and you also fetch a new instruction all at the same time in the same clock cycle. So that's called pipelining. You can also have parallelism through multiple function units. That is, modern CPUs typically have multiple ALUs and multiple FPUs, and also some load and store units and multiple jump units, and so they have more of everything that can do work and can do computations. And this will be what we are discussing about today. We can also have, and this is our last resort. So the first 3 points is basically all hardware. That's all done for you automatically. So if you just wait long enough, hardware maybe become smarter and smarter, and your programs will automatically run faster on those chips or on the newer chips. But if it's still too slow, you can use parallelism on a process or thread level. And today we are going to discuss about parallelism on a thread level. So how we do it, unfortunately, it's also the most expensive one for us as application code, application program writers. So here what we need to do is basically we need to use a programming language that supports parallel execution. And what we basically do by using threads and all that stuff, we help the compiler to produce faster code by specifying multiple execution threads. So rather than having one main thread, as you usually have in a sequential program, so one instruction is performed at another, by using threads and the programming language, you tell the compiler that there can be multiple things run in parallel. And you do that, and you specify basically multiple execution threads that the compiler can then use in order to generate more performant code. That's the idea. And usually, that's what we is the only thing left that we can do ourselves as application programmers. So pipelining pretty much already has reached its limits. So we have to get our hands dirty, kind of. And we need to use process or thread level parallelism. In general, yeah, what holds, of course, so modern CPUs and GPUs have become more and more complex, and also there are only a few companies out there who can manufacture them at all, right? What else do we have? If you talk about high performance computing, we may wish to at least talk about Flynn's taxonomy. And apparently there was a guy called Flynn or whatnot, and he came up with a taxonomy. So let's talk about concepts and corresponding machines. So what do we have? We have a single instruction, single data. So we have one instruction performed on one single piece of data. And that's, of course, that corresponds to the real-world machine, the classical von Neumann machine, as we use right here. We also have multiple instructions performed on a single data, so multiple instructions performed at the same time on some single date. This makes no sense, and of course, there is no real machine, so this machine model does not have any pendant in the real world. Just for completeness. Then what we have is we have a single instruction, multiple data, and that's a great machine model. That's basically typical CPUs with large word size, so large registers, and also this is GPUs, basically, which have huge register widths, and so you load a bunch of data into that register, so rather than loading one integer at a time, you fill up your register with multiple integers, one after the other, and then you perform a single instruction on that register, and then you basically handle multiple data with a single instruction at the same time. So SIMD, single instruction, multiple data, very important here. Modern CPUs use that, and also GPUs make heavily use of that. And then we also have MIMD, so multiple instructions and multiple data. And this is, of course, just modern processors that can work asynchronously. So where you can have the processor perform multiple instructions on multiple different data, pieces of data. So that's also what we are going to do today in C++. First of all, before you can parallelize anything, your problem needs to fulfill some properties. So first of all, your problem needs to be decomposable. So it needs to be decomposed into smaller independent computations. If that's not possible, if your problem is non-decomposable, and there are problems which have that kind of property, you can't do anything in parallel. So that's very unfortunate. But luckily, most real-world programs have at least some parts that can run independently in parallel. And now those independent computations can then run on different processor cores. That's basically the idea. But oftentimes, I mean, data and control flow is not completely decoupled. So at least you need some synchronization points. Yeah. So in order to still guarantee a correct execution of a program, this has to be ensured by you as a programmer by synchronization points and also by information exchange. We will see what that is on the next few slides somewhere. What else do we have? So we have, first of all, we have shared and distributed memory space. We, in today's lecture, are only really concerned with shared memory parallelism, so distributed memory spaces, parallelizing using distributed memory spaces is a topic on its own, so I'm not going into detail. So shared memory parallelization, that's what we are going to discuss about today. And what that basically means is that variables can be accessed and variables can be used for information exchange. So your program runs in parallel, or parts of it at least. And how do we synchronize, how do we exchange information? We do it by using variables which are still accessible by the complete program, by all parts of the program. This is why it's called shared memory parallelization, because the memory is shared, or at least it can be shared across the different threads that you are creating. Here we use different execution threads, so we will see how that can be done in C++. On the next few slides. And then on the other hand, there's distributed memory parallelization. Here in that second concept, information must be explicitly exchanged through something which is called message parsing. This is also often called message parsing programming. And really it's a huge topic in high performance computing, but it's too complex to be handled in one lecture like that. And those use really different processes. So you have one program that spawns different processes, which then do some work, and then they have to explicitly communicate through communication channels, and the model is called message passing programming. So you can, of course, also evaluate your work, and that should always be done. So evaluation, how can you evaluate parallel programs? That can be expressible in terms of, first of all, speed up. So how much faster has your program become in comparison to your original sequential version of your program? You can also talk about efficiency. So how about time reduction? And how about memory? Do we have to use more memory now, or do we can we use less memory? So efficiency. And then there's a term which you need to know about, which is called granularity. And granularity is basically the average size of subtasks that you can divide your program in. And of course, the higher the granularity of your problem, the better it is, because the more stuff you can run independently in parallel. The decision in which order a computation takes place is called scheduling. So that's another important term here. So scheduling. Yeah, that's mostly about parallel processing. So maybe let's, before we get into how to encode that in C++, so let's maybe discuss about the problems of a typical von Neumann architecture. So what's wrong with a von Neumann machine? First of all, it only uses sequential execution of a program. So we can't make any use of multiple cores. We can only use the single core at a time. Every implementation of a Turing or random access machine has to deal with a finite memory. So the concepts in mathematics are always fine, because they're just, yeah, let's assume we have an infinite band of memory, and then we have a head that runs on that piece of memory, on that tape, and it reads and writes. And I mean, that's basically the definition of a Turing machine. And you can just assume that you have infinite amount of memory. But in reality, we only have a finite amount of memory, right? That's also a huge problem. Also, one more problem is that memory is usually the bottleneck of a computation. So the thing is that every processor cycle is much faster than a memory cycle. So your processor is much faster in comparison to how fast you can access your main memory, the memory on your RAM chips. And this is also why caches have been introduced. And the idea is that the caches are some sort of special memory that are mounted directly on the CPU chip, which can be accessed much faster, but it's so expensive, you can only have little amounts. And then the idea is, whenever you initially, from your CPU, you need to access some piece of memory in the main memory, you not only read a single date, basically, but you read a whole bunch of data. You put that data into the cache, and then you put it further into the CPU and in the registers. And then if you work on the adjacent dates, basically, on the adjacent data of the data that you initially read, it's now already in the cache, and you can then access the cache much faster than the main memory. So that's, yeah, in a nutshell, the idea of caches and how to deal with the discrepancy of a processor cycle being much, much faster than a memory cycle. Also, universal computation leads to inefficient execution of application programs. Yeah, that's also true. So, of course, if you build specialized hardware, it will always be faster than a universal computation unit. So a CPU is kind of inefficient because it is universal. It can compute anything. But if you have a special implementation, you could do it in hardware. It would then run much faster. And oftentimes, I mean, Bitcoin miners, right, are specialized hardware for a given problem, namely computing hashes, essentially. Of course, again, here, because of the finite amount of memory, we can only have a finite representation of values. So an integer can only hold a fixed amount of values, and the same holds for all other data types, basically. Reliability, nowadays machines are really reliable, so that's not an issue anymore, I guess. That's an important one again, that's a heavy one. So input-output operation is done through a processor or through the processor. And that means whenever you input and output data, maybe you read some data, from a file, or you write some data back to the file. Then what the processor is basically doing, it's copying data, but that also means that the processor is blocked for any other computations. So that's also why I/O is really slow, and I told you to try to reduce the amount of input-output of your program to a minimum, because otherwise it would block the processor from doing more meaningful tasks, namely computing some results of interesting computations. And also, computer security was never really considered. So in the early days, only specialists could handle a machine anyways. And the internet was long after the first computers. So you could only really access a computer in some special rooms, and you need keys and security. So, I mean, you need to be physically present. Nowadays, computers are connected and whatsoever, so computer security was never really considered, and we also see that by the stuff that's happening around the world. So we have a bunch of limits of the typical von Neumann architecture. So, however, if you have a machine that can execute stuff in parallel, we can think if we maybe parallelize our program. But parallelizing or speeding up your program, improving it in terms of runtime, optimizing it, can be expensive. It can be a huge cost. It, in terms of time that needs to be spent, and then also of money, because you have to pay some guy that does it, or you need to do it yourself. And one question that you have to ask yourself before you start optimizing programs or certain parts of your program, you should answer the question, does it pay off? So is it worth the investment of, I don't know, almost an arbitrary amount of time and money? So let's do a simple computation. The computation has been done by a guy called Jean Amdahl, which was a processor designer at Intel, if I recall correctly. And he did the following computation in order to show the limits, basically, of what can be done in parallel. So what's the maximum speed up that can be achieved by trying to optimize a program. So TP is basically the parallel, the time that your parallel version of a program needs. This is basically the runtime of your parallelized version. And n is, of course, the the problem size. And then the time of your parallel version, assuming that you already have a parallel version of your program, is probably, you can probably say that, is greater than or equal than f times t, t prime, plus 1 minus f times t prime divided by p. And what you need to know is basically f is the parts of a program that cannot be parallelized, right? So f maybe be percentage. So I don't know, maybe say you have 20% of your program that can't be parallelized. So then it's just the sequential code times the runtime that it takes to do that kind of stuff, plus the percentage that you can parallelize, maybe 80%. Maybe you can parallelize 80% of the program, times the runtime it needs to compute that, divided by the number of processors. And the more processors you put on your problem, so you can get rid of that term, basically. So again, sequential part is f plus the parallel part is 1 minus f. And the maximal speed up can be then computed by, changing the formula a bit. So what you do is the speed up is, of course, the original runtime, the sequential runtime, divided by the runtime of the parallelized program. That's the speed up, right? So sequential version, runtime sequential version divided by runtime parallel version. Then you plug in all those terms here, and you're left with this term. And if you then increase the number of processors, and you assume that f, so the amount of sequential part is greater than zero, let's assume that for a second, then you can completely eliminate that part here by just throwing more processors on the problem. And you're left with 1 divided by f. Yeah, that's what I just said. And that's basically a good approximation for the maximal speedup that you can achieve. Okay? And if you plot that formula basically for some given problem sizes, so even if 95% of your problem can be executed in parallel, the maximum achievable speedup is only 20, which is not very much. If you hear that 95% of your problem can be run in parallel and we throw infinite amount of processors on the problem, but then still if we would have an infinite amount of processors, we still would only be able to achieve a speedup of 20. And it gets worse, of course, the less parts of your program can be run in parallel, really. Yeah, so you should evaluate first before putting huge amounts of effort in a problem which really doesn't buy you very much. That's the idea here. So that was Jean Amdahl's law. There's also, on the other hand, a law called Gustafson's law. I don't know his name. His full name, but anyhow, Gustafson basically swaps the terms of the formula in some other ways, and then he's interested in that part basically. And his idea is, if the sequential part of a program can be reduced, how could you reduce the sequential part of a program? Maybe by just throwing a larger problem, by increasing the problem size, you of course can then shrink the sequential parts of your program. Because the bigger your problem, and if, 80% of it can be parallelized, and then you increase the problem size, then you kind of make the real amount of sequential code smaller in contrast to the overall problem size. Then Gustafson's law basically applies, which I have at some point here. For instance, here this is the computation of a fourth layout, and if you just increase the number of iterations, you basically make the sequential stuff compared to the overall problem size smaller, and then it is scalable again. So in essence, basically, you have to ask yourself the question when to apply what law, and you can answer that question by, if the problem does not scale, you need to stick with Amdahl's law, because you cannot really shift the problem to your favor. But if the problem is perfectly scalable, if you just can increase the amount of iterations and all those iterations can be run in parallel, then it's probably perfectly allowed. You can apply the Gustafson's law. If the problem is perfectly scalable. That's basically the idea. How to implement an algorithm efficiently? So maybe let's ask ourselves this question here. What you really need to do, you need to understand the algorithm that you wish to craft a highly efficient implementation for. You need to understand that algorithm in all of its greatness and all its details. So if you really only know how an algorithm works halfway and you're just guessing more or less, you can't do it, right? So you need to know the algorithm. Then you need to inspect the algorithm and find some places that can maybe run, where computations may can run in parallel. You also need to understand your hardware. So how does my hardware work? What does my hardware do? And what does it mean if I write that piece of code? How does that reflect in the hardware on instructions being executed on your hardware? You should, of course, also check for state-of-the-art techniques. Because maybe let's say you have a problem and you are too slow, or your implemented solution is too slow, maybe it would already help to buy a better processor. Maybe that would already solve your problem, and then you don't have to waste huge amounts of time in implementing a more efficient algorithm. Maybe that's just a solution, but if that's not a solution, then of course you are, you have to take action and you have to craft a more efficient version of a given algorithm. Yeah, and of course that should be clear, I guess. So plan first and then implement your stuff. It could also be that you're still too slow. So that also happens if you just have an algorithm, which is the most efficient algorithm to solve your problem. And if that algorithm has a bad runtime, complexity, then even with the most efficient implementation, at some point you reach the limit and it might still be too slow. So what could you do about that? You could maybe approximate a solution, so just have a solution that's good enough, doesn't be to have the exact solution. Sometimes it's also good enough to approximate a solution. For instance, you could use genetic algorithms, which do the following. First of all, you guess a random solution and you check how good that solution is. And if it is not good or not good enough, you try to optimize according to some fitness function. And then you iteratively improve on your solution until you are good enough. And then by choosing the number of iterations that you optimize, basically can have you can reduce the runtime, right? And yeah, I mean, the idea is that maybe a good solution is better than no solution at all, and I guess that also only makes sense, really. Okay, so now it's getting C++-y again, but we had to talk about the concepts first. So how to express parallel executions in C++. How to tell the compiler, hey, here I have two separate threads of execution that can be run in parallel. C++ has, in the SDL, it has implemented, the SDL comes with some data types and functions that you can use to do that kind of stuff. And probably the most important data types that you can use to describe computations or parallel streams of executions is STUTZ thread. So std thread can be used to describe that. So that's a data type that creates a separate execution thread, and it uses shared memory. So even if you created a separate thread, that thread can still read all the data and write all the data of your program's memory. So the memory is shared across all the execution threads. That's why it's called shared memory programming. That's the constructor of thread. It looks a bit ugly if you don't like C++ anyways, and it's crude syntax or archaic syntax. Yeah, just bear with me. That's just how the constructor is defined. It's easier to use than that it looks like, so bear with me. And a variable of type thread has to be constructed explicitly, basically. So you can't just have a function be converted to a thread. So you need to explicitly use the type name thread. So implicit conversion is not allowed here by using threads. And the idea here is that a threads constructor, so this guy here, it receives a callable. So here it's just a template parameter function. Let me tell you, it's a callable. And it also accepts some optional arguments. So you can also give it, as variadic template arguments, you can give it some arbitrary number of arguments. What is a callable, first of all? Maybe a callable can be a function, which can in turn be a function pointer, can be a function object, can be a lambda function. a class implementing operator call, so the function call operator. All of those things are considered a callable because you can just call it like a function, and that's good enough. So you can give any of those things to a constructor of the thread type. Just give me a second, please. Okay, now we can continue. Where have I stopped? Okay, here, and also thread does not care about a return value. So a thread is a type. You give it some things that you wish to call, you give it some additional arguments, and a thread on itself does not really, or on its own, does not really care about the return value. So, but we will see what we can do about that in a few moments. So first of all, you cannot return data directly, but there are other means to do that. Let's have an example how we can use a thread. So we can create ourselves a class, which we call callable, because it will be a callable. We can give it two private integer variables, I and j. We can give it a constructor receiving two integer arguments that it uses to initialize its data members. What else do we do? And we provide a call operator. So we implement the call operator, and the call operator we implement to add the data members I and j, and we write the result to the command line. So that's basically what the callable should do. Then we can, of course, also just define a free function receiving two integers, and it multiplies those integers together and writes it also to the command line. We can ask if you wish to use threads, you need to include the STL header file thread. And the thread type also has a static member function, which you can directly call without any instance. You can ask for the amount of hardware concurrency available. Basically, that tells you the number of cores that your CPU chip provides. In my case, it will probably only be two because it's a small notebook i7, so I only have two hardware cores. and then you can, of course, read the number of hardware cores that you have available. And then you can create a new thread of execution. So how you do it is you create a variable of type thread, which we call t1 here, and just recall the constructor of the thread. It receives a callable. So what we can do is we can now, within the constructor of the thread t1, when we create that variable, we can construct a variable of callable type, of the callable type, and the callable constructor again takes two integers. We give it two integers, literals here in that example, 10 and 20. And then this will directly create a new execution thread, and it will call the call operator on that callable thingy here that we gave it. What else can we do? We can also create yet another execution thread, which we have in a variable called t2, also of type thread, of course. And what do we give it? We give it a function called func. So we give it this function here that it should call, and recall that the thread constructor also receives or can receive some additional arguments. So here in our case, the additional arguments, we give it 10 and 20, and the threads constructor will just pass the additional arguments to the function that it should call. So basically that thread calls the function func with the arguments 10 and 20. So you can also try it yourself, of course. We can also create a third execution thread in a variable named t3, also of type thread, of course. And we can also give it a lambda function, which is also a callable, so you can call a lambda function. And within the lambda function, we just divide 10 by 20 by 10 and then write the result back to the command line. What we then do is we join all those threads, and once all threads are finished here, we return 0 from main, and then our program is finished in total. So one question might immediately arise. you might still be able to understand what those threads do. So first of all, you have your main execution thread that runs your program that you would always have. And then here, by using the thread variables of type thread, you create new execution threads that will be spawned and then run in parallel. So your main execution thread spawns this computation here, which then runs in parallel. It also spawns this computation, which then is spawned, and it will run in parallel, and also the third thingy. And then, why do you need to join? Because maybe let's have a think about it. So the main execution thread operates in main. It spawns all those threads. And if you would not have the join, the main thread would reach return zero, and the program would be finished, and it would be done. It execution terminates. However, those threads might not be finished yet. So maybe those threads are still running in the background, but as soon as your main execution thread reaches return zero, so the end of main, your program is finished. And if you would not do the join, the main thread would not wait for all the threads that it spawned at some earlier point in time until they finished. And so the idea is, by calling the join function on those threads, is that the main thread, the main execution thread, will wait until T1 has finished its work, T2 has finished its work, and T3 has finished its work. So it will wait until all the threads that have been spawned here finish their work, and only then it will terminate and finish the program, basically. That's the idea. Otherwise, if you would not join again, your main execution thread reaches end of main, program done, bam. Although you still have other threads running. And to avoid that, you need to join the threads before you reach the end of main. That's the idea, and that's also very important to understand. Okay, so let's talk about that threads cannot return data directly. So, but what can we do about that? So how can we get a result? Maybe we spawned a new execution thread, we gave it some function that it should work on, and maybe that function produces a result. So how can we get that result back from that thread once it finished? And how can we do that? And here the idea is, we may wish to use shared memory, so we can make use of global variables. Because the good thing, I mean, there are only a few good things really about global variables, but one of the little good things about global variables is you can access those variables across all functions. And we can make use of global or shared variables to store results of those threads. And also for communication. Maybe you have two threads which run in parallel, but maybe in between they have to exchange some information back and forth. That can also happen using global variables. That can be done. And that's one of the only few legit uses of global variables, in my opinion. Again, try to minimize your usage of global variables, because global variables make your program hard to read, because you can't see in a local scope of your editor, you can't see what other things are modifying those global variables. You cannot reason about that locally. That's the main problem. Okay, so let's have an example. So let's include array, let's include IOStream and thread and vector, because vector and thread also work good together. So we will have an example here. Let's create an array of static size. So array is basically the STL wrapper around a built-in array. So let's have a fixed size array that can hold four integers, and let's call it results, because this fixed size array should be used, and you see it's a global variable, should be used to collect all the results of those threads. Then let's have a function, and we call that function power. We give that power function an integer as an ID and an integer a of which it should compute the power of. Power, maybe it's not a good, because basically it just squares the parameter a. Well, yeah, but anyway, you know what it does, right? So it squares a. It squares the parameter a and writes the result to the result vector at the specific ID that has been given to it. And you probably already know what's coming next. So we create a vector of threads, which we call threads, by the way, makes sense, I guess. Then for the number of results that we can store, so we can store four results. So basically we have a for loop running from, so the loop counter running from 0 to I smaller than 4, so 0 to 3. For each loop iteration, we create a new thread. We give that thread the power function. We give it an ID and we give it an A, which is I plus 1. And then the thread spawns a new execution thread here after it has been created, and we store that thread in our vector of threads by just calling pushback. Then we can iterate the vector of threads again to join all threads. So at this point, basically, we have a barrier here, and we wait until all threads have finished their work. And only then we continue after that point, basically. And then, so each thread has now called the power function with a unique ID. And what it does, it computes the square here of A and it stores it to the global variable at the position ID. And the position ID is unique because for each loop iteration, we gave it a different ID. And so each thread writes the result back into the results array at its own position. And so at the very end, we can write all results, so all integers of the results to the command line by just using another for loop, and it will print. What will it print, really? I plus 1 is in the first iteration 1, 1 times 1 is 1, 2 is 4, then 3 times 3 is 9, and 4 times 4 is 16. So 1, 2, 4, 16 or something like that. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then we can return from main and done. So that's basically one way to get data out of your threads by just having a global variable and storing the results in the global variable. And in our case, it's an integer array. On the last slides, we already have been smart about things. So we have been smart about things because we gave each vector its own entry in that array. But what happens if two or more threads use a global variable at the same time, trying to write or read the same memory location? What happens then? I mean, that doesn't sound too good, does it? And if you do that, your program contains what is called a race condition. And having a race condition in a program is really the worst kind of error that you can have. Because first of all, your program does rubbish. Its results change depending on the order in which threads execute stuff. It's really a hard to find error. So it's really hard to find a race condition, even if you have one. So there are no good analyzers to detect such things because it's a really hard problem. And it's also hard to fix. So you don't wish to have a race condition within your program. What's even worse, if you think your program runs perfectly fine and you are not aware of a race condition, that's even worse than having one and knowing about it, of course. And what you can do about it, what you can do about if you have multiple threads that need to write or read from or to the same memory location, you can lock critical code. So critical code is code that is executed by different threads that modifies the same piece of data. That's called critical code. And what you can do is you can lock that critical code, for instance, with something which is called a mutex lock. Mutex is short for mutual exclusive, meaning that only one thread at a time is allowed to execute that critical section in your code. And here, yeah, that's what I already said. So if you have a mutex lock, and if you lock your critical code, that essentially means that only one thread is allowed to execute that locked code at a time. Let's have a concrete example. Let's have IOStream again, thread, of course, because we need to wish to spawn multiple threads. Let's have vectors, then we can have a vector of threads. And also now we wish to use a mutex lock, which you can use by including mutex here. Let's have a global variable results, a vector of integers results. This is the vector where we wish to store our results. Let's have a power function. Again, I call it a power, but it should rather be called squared because it takes an argument and it squares that argument and puts it into a new variable b. And then it pushes back b to the result vector. And you can already see where this is going, because if we call the power function from multiple threads at the same time, then also multiple threads will try to push back to the end of that vector, which is not a good idea. And this code is considered critical code if we execute that code in different execution threads. And that's what we're going to do to show you an example how you can lock critical code, of course. So again, let's have a vector of thread, which you call threads. Then we just spawn, I don't know, like nine threads from 1 to 9. So 9 threads, bit of an odd number, but anyhow. Yeah, and we create a new thread and we give that thread the power function to execute, and also we give it some argument. Ah, yeah. And then each execution thread that we spawn here will call that power function and will execute that critical piece of code here. And then the resulting vector here, we store the handle in the vector threads. So that's basically a thread handle, and we store it in the vector threads. Then here we create a barrier, so we join all threads of the vector that are stored in the vector here, such that the main thread, the main execution thread, waits at this point in time until all of the threads we just spawned finished their work. And then we print out all the results. And you can try that at home. You can also increase the number of iterations, and you will find that the vector results contain some rubbish or not the correct data that you would expect. And this is because you execute and access this global variable here from multiple threads at the same time. And then you just get rubbish results. But because what happens is multiple threads are reading the results variable, see, yeah, okay, this maybe contains two elements. And now both execution threads think that the results vector only contains two elements, so they will just append a third one. And I mean, but if two threads append another element, the answer should be plus two, so basically 4 in our method example. But in the worst case, it would only be 2, because both read a vector of length 2 and just appended one thing, and then, yeah, it's a 3. But so that's just nonsense. So the result doesn't really make any sense. That's called a race condition then. what you can do about this is you can create another global variable of type mutex, which you call results mutex. I mean, you can name that variable whatever you like, but usually you create a mutex and you name the mutex lock according to your variable that you want to protect. By having the same prefix, for instance, results, and then underscore mutex. I mean, that's just convention, and it makes it very easy to read. So what that essentially means, that for each global variable that is accessed by multiple threads, we can give it its own mutex lock. So for each global variable that you need to protect, for instance here, results, we have a mutex lock, so a variable of type mutex, which is also a global one, and we call it results mutex. And what we then do is, before we execute that critical code here, this is the critical line which modifies the global variable results. This we wish to lock. And you can do that by create a lock guard, Logguard is a data type, again, which comes with mutex here. You give it the type of logs that you wish to use. So let me tell you, there are not only mutex logs, there are also spin logs and different kinds of logs that you can use. But for most of the time, nobody cares and all guys are just using mutex logs. So here you tell, I would like to have a log guard of type mutex, basically, which I give a name, guard, for instance, because it guards the critical code. I give it as a parameter the results mutex, so the corresponding mutex of the variable I wish to access. And after I've created this log, basically, I can, without fear, I can now modify the global variable. And after I've done that, I'll reach the end of the power function. And at the very end, the guard variable of type logguard goes out of scope. And whenever a variable of type logguard goes out of scope, its destructor, which is of course automatically called here, its destructor will give the log free again. So at this line, the log will be locked. So the thread that came first now takes the log and says, ah, that's mine. Then it executes the code. And once the guard, once the log is destroyed, then the thread says, okay, now this piece of code is free and available again. And another thread can try to get the log. That's basically the idea. Whenever you need that kind of stuff, you probably will need to look it up. So you would look up how to create a log guard with a mutex log, and you would write some code like that. So I don't expect you to learn that. Because you don't need to do that frequently, but if you ever need to do that, here's how. And you can also, of course, find on the internet how it works and how it can be used. So, that was it about logs. Now we can also have atomics. Oh, what the heck is atomic? Sounds dangerous. If the critical global data that you need to share across multiple threads is small or is a primitive type, then you can also use std atomic rather than using a mutex log. atomic is a data type that you can use to make your own data types atomically accessible. Meaning, if you modify that thing and maybe read and write a value, it happens at the same time as an atom, basically. An atom is non-dividable. That's the Greek word atom. You can't divide that into any smaller parts, so it's all at once. And then nothing bad happens. We have an example in a second. So you can use atomic to make accessing a value read and write atomic. So you read and write basically at the same kind of time. and if you use atomics rather than logs, so if you write clever code, then it's also called log-free programming. If you just use atomics and don't use any logs, it's called log-free programming. That's the best thing that you can achieve. What log-free programming is really also not that easy. It cannot be always done. Sometimes you just have to fall back to logs. I just wanted to show that for completeness. And I just wanted to show you a fancy header file name. So if you need to use atomic, you need to include the atomic header file. Let's have a global variable, which we call global int. And let's now make it an atomic variable. We make it an atomic variable by just having in the atomic type, giving it as a template parameter, the type that we actually wish to have being atomic. And then in the integers constructor, we just initialize it to zero. And now this global int is an atomic global integer. So, and now you probably already know what happens next. So we can now have a function, inc global, which does increment the global integer here, which is now atomic. So meaning that adding one or incrementing the global integer now happens at once. So the value is written and then it's incremented. Whatever the value was, it's now incremented by one, all at the same time. And now what we can do is we can have a vector of threads again. Create a bunch of threads, namely here 10, 10 threads, and each thread we say should execute the increment global function. And then we push back the handle, so the thread variable we push back to the vector threads. And then of course we have our barrier here, so we join all the threads, meaning the main execution thread will at this point will wait until all those threads have finished their work. And then we can print the global integer. And the global integer now in this setup here, having an atomic counter, will count, yeah, like 10, right? No, 9, because at the beginning it's 0, then it's 1, and then it's incremented like 10 times, 0 to 10. It's 10, okay, so it will print 10, always. Because even though we have different threads modifying the global variable, each thread can only modify that thing atomically. That means if one thread is in the process of reading and incrementing that variable, the other thread can't do it. So there can't be two threads reading that thing at the same time because it's atomic. So only one thread can read and increment at a time, and then the other threads will increment and read and increment at a time. So basically here you avoid a race condition in that case by using an atomic type. That's the general idea. Okay, let's talk about a few more fancy types that come with the STL. There's also a thing called packaged task, and this helps you with the problem that threads cannot return data directly. If you still wish to return some piece of data, even though thread can't do it, you can use a package task for that. Or you just, like as shown on the last slides, you just create a global variable to store your results. Usually people do that, but there's also a type called packaged task. And it uses a future to return a value. So future is also a funny type that we will see about how it works. Yeah, future is not only a funny, but also a very useful type. Because a future gives you a value that will be available in the future. That's why it's called future, because it's kind of a future value. How does it work? So the idea is that you create a package task, that you get the future from it, that you execute the task, and then you can obtain the result from the future. It sounds kind of weird, but yeah, that's how it works. So you obtain the result from the future when the thread will have finished your computation. And the great thing about that is that this avoids using global variables, which is probably a cool thing. So let's have an example on that. So what you need is a thread again. Let's use also vector. And here we also need to use future. Let's have a nice function that we can use as a callable for the thread. This is just testing purposes, of course, but then encode meaningful computations here rather than just having some primitive functions. But what can you do? How it works is you create a variable of type packaged tasks, a task. You give it the function, the callable that you wish to execute as a package task. You need to also give it the signature of that task to be executed here. So this function returns one int and it gets two ints as a parameter. So that's basically the function's signature. Then you can ask for its future. So basically you can then ask the task, give me the future. So in the future, at some point, the result will be available. And we can, from the task, we can get the future. And here we will get our future integer, so the result. And once the result is ready, once the future is now, the result will contain the value of the computation that has been executed. What we now do is we have now this task and we have gotten the future from it. We can now create a thread and move that task into the thread. So here at this point, we spawn a new execution, which executes the function here with the arguments 2 and 10. The result is so 20. First of all, we join that thread, so the main execution thread now waits until that thingy here is finished. And we can now ask the future if it has the result. And so this call result.get, it will give us the value from the future. When the future is now, it will have the value, and this will print 20. So you can really write that into your editor and give it a try. So it's quite funny to fiddle around with that. So that's package task. And here you get a return value, and here you see you don't have to use a global variable. If you don't wish to, you can just use package task, and you can get the result by using a future. Some other useful function is called async, and async creates a new asynchronous task. So it's a very elegant function, at least to my opinion. It starts a new asynchronous task, so and it spawns a new execution thread, and it returns a future, which you can then eventually ask for its value once the value is ready. If your problem is appropriate, yeah, I mean, it's, of course, it depends on your specific problem that you need to solve, but you might wish to consider async. If the problem is appropriate, please use async, I guess. It can generate new software or hardware threads, and two policies are allowed. So you can really launch an asynchronous call, meaning that the new execution thread directly starts its computation. Or you can also specify another launch policy, a deferred one. This is basically lazy evaluation. If you use a deferred launch policy, it will only start the computation once you query for the result, basically by calling future.get, by asking the future for its result, and if you have chosen the deferred launch policy, then it will start computing. Well, on the other hand, if you use async launch policy, it will directly start running and trying to compute your result. Let's have an example. Let's have a simple function which just returns 10. I mean, just for showcase, very simple function here. And let's call async, and let's call it with the asynchronous launch policy, basically meaning whatever function I give you, in this case return 10, directly executes it in a separate execution thread. It will give me as a result a future of int, which I can then ask for its value. So, and then here I can use the value, which will be 10, right? So, because return 10 will just return 10, doesn't do too much complicated stuff here. So that's also a very elegant way to doing it, and it also looks quite nice. And then the question is, yeah, okay, that was easy. That was just one task, but that wasn't, too powerful. So the idea is, how can I compute a bunch of tasks in parallel? How does that work? Yeah, you can just use a vector futures, of course, and loops, and then just call to async, and the result just push back in a vector of futures. But caution, one caution, if you call get on a future, you can only do that once, because once you got the result from the future, you have it. The future no longer has that result. Otherwise, you would end up with undefined behavior trying to call get on the same future twice. So please don't do that. So let's again have a very simple function just for showcase. It receives an integer as a parameter and then directly returns it. So it doesn't do any meaningful stuff. But this could be a function in your problem case which does some meaningful stuff, really. Okay, so let's have a look. So now we can create a vector of futures of integers. So the futures will each hold an integer. And we now have a vector which we call futures of a future of int. Okay. And what we can do is we can, in a for loop, we can now call the async function, have asynchronous calls to return arg, just give it some argument here. And the resulting future we push back in a vector of futures. And then we are done. So this the loop then spawns 10 execution threads that are directly executed. And we can collect the results by iterating over the futures. And for each future, we ask your future.get, give me the result, and we put the results back in a new vector of integers, which then finally contains our results. And then we can print our results to the command line or do whatever stuff you wish to do with that. That's another way, another interesting way. Almost done with all those funny types. There is one more type which can be used together with future. And this type is called promise. So you can also basically describe computations even though you're missing on some values. That means you can basically create a promise, say, yeah, I promise you that I will have that value at some point, but then you can still go ahead with your computation even though a value is still missing. And you can then also fulfill your promise at some point, and then the computation will just start and give you finally the value. Let's have an example on that. So compute even if values are missing. So how does it work? You create a promise, and the promise will be fulfilled in the future, hopefully. You then prepare a computation, and the computation will start as soon as the promise is fulfilled and the value is ready to use. So you can set up a computation that is depending on a value which is not yet there. That's the idea. And also, as in real life, try to fulfill your promises that you make, because otherwise you will, in the best case, you will receive a broken promise exception. And in the worst case, you're just waiting for eternity, because now a computation at some point is waiting for a value that you never give it to that computation, and thus nothing really happens. So that's probably not very good. So how does it work? Let's have a power function which gets a future integer, and it just again it should be called squared, right? So it just gets a future integer, and it does some computation with that future integer. And here you can create a promise. You can, from that promise, you can get a future by calling get future. And the future that you obtained by the promise, here you have a promise which is not yet fulfilled, you get a future, and you move that future to the power function that you then call in a separate execution thread that you just spawned with async. And of course, async gives you a future as a result. And then you can, for instance, sleep for 10 seconds, so the main thread sleeps here. The other thread, the other execution thread that you spawned here with that call, is running and waiting. It's waiting for the promise to be fulfilled. And here the main thread at this point is just sleeping for 10 seconds. So you can also wait in your program. You can just wait by using this thread sleep for, and then you give it an amount of time, like your 10 seconds. Then you can maybe, let's say after the main thread waits 10 seconds, the other thread just give me a second again. All right, let's continue. Yeah, I'm sorry. So I should probably just exit Skype and Slack and all that good stuff. Anyhow, the main execution thread now waits for 10 seconds. The other thread is already spawned, but it can't continue because it's still pending on the promise to be fulfilled, which we can fulfill by setting a value. So here we can use a p.setValue and fulfill our promise and finally give it some integer. And so now the promise has been fulfilled and the future value is available here, and the thread can work on the power function basically and compute the result. And finally, we can then get the result from that future that async returned to us, and we can print it, and it should print, I don't know, what should it print? Like 100, I guess, right? So 100 times 100 is 10 times 10 is 100. All right. Okay, at last. So let me show you some example how you could improve on your code, make it faster. Let's have one scenario where we check how fast we can make our program, and we are starting basically with a naive version of the program, and then we try to speed things up. So what we can do, or what we do for that, is we just test different versions of matrix multiplication. So maybe let me briefly talk you through the setup. So the setup basically was, yeah, we test different versions of a matrix multiplication. We are beginning with a naive implementation. And what we do is we multiply then a 3000 times 3000 matrix with another 3000 times 3000 matrix. That means that we multiply two matrices, and each matrix has, of course, 9 million entries. And that might take a while to compute, basically. I run all tests on my notebook, which is an Intel Core i7 at 2.6 gigahertz. Has only two hardware cores, so not very powerful, but it has hyper-threading, but usually that doesn't buy you much if you have a large problem. So usually if you split it up in multiple execution threads, then only really the real hardware cores count, basically. So that doesn't buy you too much here. I use the GCC or G++ and the Clang++ compiler. I use the POSIX thread model, and my G++ compiler was GCC version 8.4, and the Clang compiler is in version 10 that I have used. So one grain of salt, basically. Every test was only run once, so that's a very poor measurement. If you ever have to do some empirical evaluations, you have to run your tests more than once. Usually, like, you can do it 10 times, then you get rid of the best and worst runtime, and then you build the average of the remaining 8 values to get a relatively good measurement. So this is a very poor measurement, but it still proves my point. So let's see. Let's implement a matrix, and let's be naive about it. So we just have a struct matrix, mat. It has a number of rows, a number of columns, and it has its data members. So the matrix entries are stored in a nested vector of doubles. We give it some constructor, we give it some output functionalities. We give it some multiplication operator, which implements ordinary matrix multiplication. So basically here we are creating a new matrix for the result of sufficient size. Then we have our three loops that you already saw, because it was already some of your homework, if I recall correctly, yeah, to implement the matrix multiplication. And then, yeah, we just build the row and column wise scalar products, basically, and make them as entries of our result. And here is main, so we just read the first integer, the first command line parameter, interpret as it as an integer, create two matrices. Basically, I call the program with an additional integer argument of 3000. The first matrix we initialize with all twos. The second matrix we initialize with all entries of three as a double. And then here we call our matrix multiplication and have our result. And here we need to access our result and check if, I don't know, the value 00 has been computed successfully. It should be like 180,000 or 18,000 should be the correct result, if I recall correctly, given those input matrices. So, and if we compile the program without any other compiler switches or whatnot, here are the runtimes. Maybe first have a guess. So how long does it take to compute that matrix multiplication for a 9 million entries matrix times a 9 million entries matrix? So how long does it take? Come up with a guess. Maybe. And let's check. So the runtime is, like, with G++ is like 13 minutes and about 18 seconds. And with Clang is a bit slower. It's like 30 minutes and 48 seconds. That's our naive first implementation. We haven't done anything. We have not been smart about it. So let's see how we can improve on those numbers here. Because, yeah, I mean, it's almost a quarter of an hour. So what do we do? We just don't do anything. We don't do any changes to the code. But what we do is, again, here, same code as on the last slide. We stick to our naive implementation. But we now use the compiler switch OFAST, which tells the compiler perform every optimization possible, every optimization that it knows should be performed, including some dark arts. So the compiler really knows tricks that you can't even imagine to make your code run fast and transform your code in such a way that it runs as fast as possible. That's the one switch that we use, the one compiler switch. The other compiler switch that we are using is my architecture, and we set it to native. That tells the compiler, please generate executable code that only runs on this processor. So the compiled program is then only usable on platforms with the same processor, which gives the compiler a few more opportunities and tricks to use. So maybe if my CPU has some special hardware instructions, it can make use of them. With the grain of salt being that this program is no longer portable, so it only works for the for systems with the same exact same processor. But we don't care. We wish to obtain performance, and let's just use that. And now again, have a lucky guess on what the times are now. Give you a moment. Just imagine a number. So last time it was like 30 minutes and some seconds. Okay, now let me present. So now we are with G++. We are at 2 minutes 30. And prior, so we shaved off 10 minutes and 48 seconds, which is quite impressive just by using a compiler switch or two compiler switches and using Clang. Clang catched up. It was a bit slower on the naive run, but with optimizations, it's now even faster than GCC, about like 1 second. So we shaved off 11 minutes and 19 seconds. Okay, so what can we do better than that? We can try to be now smart about it. So now the compiler is already at its smartest settings, kind of. Now we can also try to be smart ourselves. And we can try to make use of data locality. I told you about the cache, right? I told you that the CPU is much faster than a CPU cycle is much faster than a memory cycle. So if we need to extensively touch the main memory, that's probably not a good thing. So if you can stick in the cache, that's probably better. And now the optimization that we are performing is the following. We are now using, instead of a nested vector, we are using just one vector, one single vector of double. Why is that? Because if we have a nested vector, then that means that we have one row in memory, I don't know, somewhere here, and we have we then also have some other row of the matrix somewhere else, somewhere completely different in memory. And then, so basically the memory is completely fragmented. And I also told you that if the processor loads a thing from the main memory, it passes it through the cache. So it not only reads a single piece of memory, but it reads a whole cache line, basically, which is then promoted to the cache. And then finally, it's processed. And then if the next value is to be read, it can hopefully be accessed in the cache directly, because we made use of that. If you don't know exactly what that means, then the idea is basically to keep that memory tightly together in memory. So whenever possible in the main memory, we wish to organize the memory one element after the other without fragmenting it around in the memory too much. And we do that by having a vector of doubles, so just one vector that stores all of the matrix elements, basically. All right, so what else? Now imagine a new number. So have you improved? Have you gone worse again? So let's see. Come up with a guess. Okay, I'll present the answer. So we have improved just a little bit. So like we could shave 10 and 12 seconds off that runtime here. So G++ is now at 2 minutes 19 or 20 almost, and Clang is like 2 minutes 17, so pretty close. Okay, let's see what else we can do. We can make use of even more data locality. Here we need to be really smart about things. So again, we are now working with a single vector of doubles. Oh, and I forgot to mention we now overloaded the call operator to be able to easily index using two indices index into the one-dimensional data array or vector now. So we have those additional helper functions, but never mind. And the idea now here is that we change the two innermost for loops. We change the innermost for loops. So usually you have one for loop for the rows of the left-hand side, then for the columns of the right-hand side, and then calls of the left-hand side, and then one K, a third loop that computes the scalar products, basically the row and column-wise scalar products. But if you change those loops, the memory accesses here, in terms of if we organize everything as a one-dimensional vector, the memory accesses have been improved to our favor. So we can now access memory that is pretty much close together. So we can make more use of the cache, and we can use the cache more effectively. Okay, now come up again with a lucky guess. So have you improved? And if so, by what amount? Okay, so I let you know the answer now. We could improve a lot. So we are now using G++ at 20 seconds and Clang++ at 19 seconds. So we could shave off a huge amount of runtime. So 2 minutes and almost also 2 minutes using Clang or Clang++. So locality is really a key to performance. So if possible, try to organize your data such that you can work with the cache and use the cache to your advantage. Do not scatter around memory, do not scatter around data across all over the main memory, basically. So have it all tightly together such that the cache can be used effectively. Because again, the clock rate of the CPU is much faster than the clock rate of memory. And otherwise, the processor can only wait until the memory has basically arrived. And if you can use the cache, that happens much faster. Now let's parallelize as well. And also we still keep with the same stuff, the same tricks that we already did. So the code is almost the same, but here we are making use of OpenMP. And I presented OpenMP to you in one of the last lectures here, which makes it very easy to parallelize for loops, for instance. So we can have, we can say, yeah, this should be a OpenMP parallel for loop. Each thread should have its private copy of row, call, and k, so of the loop counter variables. And all the threads should share the three matrices, LHS, RHS, and result. So those matrices should be shared across all those threads, and each thread should have its own individual loop counter. And you can also schedule determine the schedule. It should be done statically. So it just means that you now create a bunch of threads, and you divide the outermost for loop, so basically the loop range here, the range that you specify with that count and comparison and all that stuff. That loop is now distributed across multiple threads. Okay, so it's now distributed about on multiple threads, that piece of work, so that now multiple threads work on the outermost for loop. And that's probably a good idea. So again, have a lucky guess what we could do with that. And also keep in mind that I have two hardware cores, two real processors in my on my CPU here. So, okay, what could we do? We could shave the runtime in half, so to say. So for G++, we could get rid of another 10 seconds. And for Clang++, we could get rid of another 8 seconds. So this only makes sense. So previously we have been around like 20 seconds and yeah, as I only have two cores, we can pretty much shave the problem in half approximately. So yeah, ending up on 10 seconds here, like almost 10 seconds and here 11 seconds. Okay, so I personally, I find that pretty impressive. So I don't know what you think about that, but I think that's awesome. So we started like with over 13 minutes, and now we are left with 10 and 11 seconds with being a bit smart about it and trying to help our compiler, so which is great news. So let's talk about the most important optimization flags that you might need to use. So first of all, you should try to always use a modern standard, so a modern style. So set the standard to C++ and then probably you wish to go above 11. So G++ and Clang already provide full support for C++ 17. So you should always try to stick with the modern style. You can use the optimization flag, so dash uppercase O and then an X, and X can be 0 to turn the optimizations completely off. You can have them on, you can add with the dash O2, you can add some more optimizations, and O3 is basically some insane optimizations that can be done. You can only, if that's not fast enough, you can also use dash O fast, which basically enables all dash O3 optimizations and it invalidates also the standard compliance of your compiler. So, but sometimes it's acceptable. Sometimes that's acceptable. And it uses fast math and here some other concepts that you can look up for yourself if you're interested in that kind of stuff. And I mean, especially for floating point numbers. So if you, what do you do? If you have A plus B plus C, and if you do A plus B first and then plus C, or if you do B plus C first and then plus A, in maths, that's the same stuff, right? That the result should be the same. Yeah? So the ordering of addition does not really matter. But the problem is in computer science, that's not the case because of rounding errors for floating point numbers. So B plus C and then plus A, or A plus B and then plus C, might not necessarily be the same value. And if you use O fast, it enables the fast math flag, which basically tells you, yeah, just assume that to be equivalent, and then the compiler is free to move some instructions around to make better use of pipelining and all that good stuff. That's basically the idea. Yeah, it might be dangerous, so be careful what your domain is. If you can just say, yeah, forget about standard compliance, be very careful, because you have also keep in mind that each trick that the compiler pulls off, so each compiler optimization that is run is a code transformation. So your code is transformed to, and it's transformed into something which hopefully runs more efficiently. Whenever you run your a code transformation, you also have a chance to introduce an error, because maybe the transformation was not quite correct. So the more transformations you're running, the higher the chances for the compiler introducing mistakes. Of course, the compilers are all well tested, you can believe me on that. But yeah, I mean, each transformation is an opportunity for errors, of course. And you can use as an important flag my architecture and specify to native to generate architecture specific code, and we also use that flag. You can also disable all assertions, so by specifying do not debug, the symbol no debug, and then you basically disable all assertions in your code. Sometimes also those flags might be helpful. You can look up what they do at home, so it's not very important here. And maybe also you wish to look up Zflex, so link time optimization equals full. So use full link time, also known as whole program optimizations. So basically, usually your program comprises multiple C files or C++ files. And if you have full link time optimization, the compiler compiles each individual compilation unit into an object code and keeps that object code in memory. And as it compiles then the other modules, it basically crafts a huge object file where all your code is in. So it puts all your code in one kind of file. And then it can perform optimizations across the whole program, which can really, can give you really amazing fast code. But it needs huge amounts of RAM, and it's really expensive. So like if you compile Firefox or some Chrome browser in full LTO mode, that can easily grow to a large two-digit figure, a gigabyte figure, if not more than 100 gigabytes even. So that might be expensive for you as a person. Maybe some recommendation here. I want to make you aware of a tool called Compile Explorer. And also I wanted to discuss now at last some points which you probably wish to keep in mind. So some important facts. So really, please don't do what libraries and compilers can do for you. So don't try to be extra smart, because you can believe me, if you need to write, for instance, a hash function, and then you think, times a power of two, I can just do some left shifts. And you can believe me that the compiler knows all these tricks. So your best bet is just write clean code, express intent, and then the compiler is usually able to see through your code and sees or understands what your code is supposed to do, and then it can optimize accordingly. So don't try to be smart yourself. The compiler is already smart for you. And also you can just use library functions. We will have a great example on the next slides, if I recall correctly. So very important, write readable code. Don't try to be enormously clever. Rather express intent. First of all, it helps your colleagues to read your code. And also it will help the compiler to be able to understand the code. So sometimes if you try to be too smart about things, you make it only worse, because then the compiler doesn't understand what you're trying to do. And then it cannot apply any optimization, because the compiler has to guarantee correctness, and it cannot just assume stuff. And so if the compiler doesn't understand your code, it can't do anything about it. Most of the time, the compiler will be able to see through your code. We will have an example on the next slide as well. There's a tool which I will present you also on the next slide, which is called Compiler Explorer. You can access it on godbolt.org. And there's a corresponding YouTube talk, or talk on YouTube, from CPP conference. I don't know which year exactly, but this is a great talk. So if you have some free time and you're interested in that kind of stuff, please attend or watch the talk, the recording here. The talk's name is "What Has My Compiler Done For Me Lately?" It's by Matt Gottbold. That's also why this domain is named that way. And Compile Explorer is a tool where you can write some piece of code in basically on a web page, and then it will generate the assembly code. And the assembly code is kind of that code that runs on your hardware eventually. And you can choose from different compilers and use different compiler settings without having to install all the compilers yourself. So you can basically have a look on what the compiler generates in terms of assembly code, and if performance matters to you, that is a really helpful thing. So if performance matters, never make assumptions based on your gut feeling, because modern systems are way too complex to understand what's going on under the hood, and way too complex to make decisions about your gut feeling. So whenever performance is important to you, you just need to run on some test data, and you just need to measure runtimes and I don't know, memory usage and all that stuff. Measure, and then from those measurements, then you can build yourself an opinion and try to optimize accordingly. But never trust your gut feelings that is not good, really. And also test your code for correctness. So whenever you applied an optimization and also you added some new compiler switches, test if your code still runs correctly. Also measure, has it become faster? So sometimes you can even make it worse by specifying more compiler flags. So again, test and then measure, and then you have reliable data, and then you can make your decisions. Don't just use gut feeling. Test different optimization flags and see if they improve on performance. If they sometimes they make your code slower, so that's again why you need to measure, and just fiddle around with that. And you can also test different compilers and compiler versions. So I mean, you already saw in the last few slides that GCC and Clang++ differ a bit in terms of performance, but that also highly depends on the target program. Maybe the target program is some linear algebra computation. Maybe Clang++ is able to better optimize that kind of problems. But on the other hand, maybe you say you have a different problem from a different domain. Maybe GCC's optimizations are better. So yeah, you can also test different compilers and see if also the compiler versions make a difference. And of course, try to prefer a stable compiler version over some development version to avoid having bugs introduced because you used a buggy compiler. Yeah, check what the compiler again can do for you. So let's give ourselves the task finding the minimum of four integer values. So this is also be useful for the final project. There will be a task where you not only need to find the minimum but the maximum. Just wait until in 2 weeks and I will explain what I mean by that. But anyhow, let's give ourselves the task to find the minimum of four integer values. And this is, by the way, Compile Explorer. Here you can write some code and then it will show you how the assembly looks like. And here you can specify different compilers in different compiler versions, and then you can specify some flags and see what assembly is generated. So, and we can be smart about it. Find the minimum of four integers using some handcrafted function. So you can do it with only three comparisons. So that's the most efficient way that you can determine the minimum of four integers. First of all, you assume a to be the minimal integer, and then you check if b is if b is even smaller, then you say, yeah, okay, then b must be the minimum. Then you check if c is even smaller, then you say, oh, okay, c is the minimum. And then you check if d is even smaller. If so, then it can only be d as the minimum. Otherwise, it's m, whatever that was assigned to. So you can do it in only three comparisons. And you can now think, oh, I'm very clever because yeah, I could figure that out. So first of all, you have to think about that because it's not even that easy to see that you can do it that way. So, and yeah, oh, much clever, very smart, basically. So, but yeah, you could also be lazy about it because what you could also do is you could also just include algorithm, and there is a std minimum implementation, which you just give a list of integers and it will find the minimum for you. And maybe now let's see what the compiler generates. And the compiler will generate the exact same code, basically. It will use some different registers, but it really generates the same code. So don't waste your time really on trying to improve on crap like this. Just use library functions like the STL, and if you express your intent, the compiler will usually be smart enough to see what you're trying to do, and it will generate the code accordingly. I mean, here it's the same code. So, and here you saved some time and you did not have to come up with that kind of stuff here. So quick recap. So we talked today about why high performance computing matters. We talked also about hard physical limits. When does it pay off? So we talked about Amdahl's and Gustafson's law. I presented to you the four levels of parallelism, parallel programming in C++. So what C++ constructs in the STL can be used to specify computations that run in parallel. We talked about optimizing compilers and what they can do for you. We also talked about briefly Compiler Explorer, so a tool that you can use to check if the compiler is smart enough or what the compiler does, basically. And very important, express intent and do not trust your gut feeling. So that's a very important outcome of this lecture. All right. Other than that, that would be it for today. I would say have a nice weekend and see you next week. Bye-bye.